Beverly Smith lied. For the past 46 years, I've lived at 4208 Lorraine, Dallas, Texas. Today is October 13th, 2012. Last year, on my 85th birthday, my daughter Mary said that she had arranged for a DVD to be made of my life. I was very flattered. However, I thought it would be so much more interesting to include a short history of our six families. They are the Braggs, the Smiths, the McGowans, the Foshees, the Lydes, and the Deloaches. Except for the Lydes, all the families eventually moved to Alabama. Traveling then was so very difficult, as it was mostly wilderness with so few roads or bridges. I will start with the Braggs and the Smiths. In 1585, Thomas Bragg married Mary Newport in London, England, and they were the beginning of the Bragg family in America. Thomas and Mary, his two brothers, and her father, Peter Newport, sailed from England to America in the early 1600s. Newport News, Virginia was named for Peter Newport. Thomas and Mary's descendant, Peter Newport Bragg, was my great-great-great-great-grandfather. He joined the Continental Army when he was 16 and fought in the Battle of Cowpens, Guilford Courthouse, and Holbrook's Hill. He was born in 1763 in Virginia and died in Lowndes County, Alabama in 1841. This past May 2013, at the cemetery in Braggs, Alabama, the Daughters of the American Revolution held a ceremony to honor Peter Newport Bragg for his service to his country. Here are four of his descendants, my two first cousins, Halton Smith and Dora Smith Haas, and my two other cousins, Ryan Terry and Julia Fellows. In the 1840s, Peter Newport Bragg, Jr. and his wife, Martha Crook, moved from Lowndes County, Alabama, to what would become Camden, Arkansas. He was married to Martha Crook, and they had six children. One of them was my great-grandfather, Walter Lawrence Bragg. Peter and Martha built a lovely home there that is still being used by the family. They can show you where a cannonball entered the house during the war between the states. My grandmother Smith said that we must never call it the Civil War. My father said that his happiest summers growing up were when his family would leave Montgomery and visit their cousins in Camden. Walter Lawrence Bragg was studying for his law degree at Harvard. Because of the tension between the Southern and Northern students, he left Harvard and received his law degree in Arkansas. He joined the Confederacy when the war began and was made a captain and wounded in the Battle of Murfreesboro. Mother had a great uncle, Joseph McGowan, who was killed in that same battle. During the war, Walter Bragg returned to Marion, Alabama to marry Susan Lockett. Her parents, my great-great-grandparents, were the Napoleon Locketts, who had moved from Virginia to Alabama. The Locketts had such a lovely home on 7 acres that was famous for its lovely gardens. Their home had such beautiful furnishings that they were forced to sell after the war. At the beginning of the war, Mrs. Lockett was asked by Governor Andrew Moore to find an artist to design a flag for the Confederacy. Nicola Marshall was the artist. It was the first flag of the Confederacy known as the Stars and Bars. It was used in the early part of the war. However, it was later replaced by another flag as they thought it was too similar to the Union flag. Okay. Here shows both flags in this lithograph of the Battle of Chickamauga. This is a Confederate flag that was designed to be used only in the battles and was known as a battle flag. After the war, Walter Bragg became one of Alabama's most prominent leaders. He was the first president of the Alabama Bar Association, the president of the newly created Railroad Commission. President Cleveland appointed him to the Interstate Commerce Commission in Washington. He was honored by the state of Alabama. They especially thanked him for his work during the difficult time during the Reconstruction era. Walter and Susan Bragg had a son, Walter Bragg Jr., and a daughter, Eugenia, my grandmother. In 1888, she married Paul Wright Smith. He and his father, William Henry Smith, had moved from Connecticut to Alabama in 1847 to be in the Cotton Belt. They were prominent cotton brokers. This was the home he and his wife, Julia Hannon, had on their cotton plantation near Montgomery, and this was their home in Montgomery. The first Smith in our family to arrive in this country was the Reverend Henry Smith. He arrived in Connecticut around 1636 from England. Since then, there has always been a male in the Smith family. Paul and Eugenia had 7 children. 2 died at an early age. Left to right is Uncle Genius, my father, and Grandmother Smith holding Anton and Uncle Walter. My grandfather Smith died of a heart attack in 1903. It was a difficult time for my grandmother Smith financially. She converted the upstairs of her home to be Montgomery's first apartment. When my father and his brothers were grown, they saw that she never had to worry about money again. Here is Grandmother Smith with her children. Back row, left to right, is my father, Uncle Genius, and Uncle Walter. Front row, left to right, is Uncle Luther, Grandmother Smith, and Aunt Virginia. She had a car and driver. Neither of my grandmothers ever learned to drive. When Eugene and I were in Montgomery, every week Mother would dress us up for Grandmother Smith's weekly visit. She was very active in many historical societies as a DAR, Colonial Dames, Daughters of the Confederacy. She was a talented writer and had some of her stories and poems published. She was very instrumental in the preservation of the first White House of the Confederacy. There is a picture hanging there of her, as well as a portrait of her grandmother, Mary Clay Lockett. I remember how much my mother respected her and my father adored her. My grandmother Smith lived in the same house after she married, and my father grew up there. Every Sunday, the family would go to St. John's Episcopal Church, which was built in 1848, and a pew is marked where Jefferson Davis, president of the Confederacy, sat. Our family still attends St. John's Church, and when I visit, it's like a family reunion. Here is Father around the age of 10 at George Washington's birthday celebration. Growing up in Montgomery, Father attended Stark Military School. As a young man, in 1915, he moved to Galveston, Texas to learn the cotton business. When World War I began, he was stationed at an officer's training school in Georgia. At graduation, he said that he was so surprised and so thrilled that he had been made a captain. He served in both France and Germany, and after the war, moved to Quanah, Texas to start Eugene B. Smith Cotton Company. The cotton business had become very active in West Texas. I have never known anyone who was more of an extrovert than my father. He enjoyed everyone. His greatest loves were his family, his business, and golf. My mother often said she would do anything that would give her the pleasure that Father got from going to the office or playing golf. He was way ahead of his time in knowing the importance of staying fit. He worked out every day. He was a big supporter of the YMCA and was honored for the donations that he often gave the association. The YMCA was across the street from the Cotton Exchange. Father paid for half the membership to the YMCA for everyone who worked for him. So many companies are doing things like that today. Father was an excellent businessman. Eugene B. Smith and Associates became one of the largest cotton merchandising businesses in the country and had offices from coast to coast. Father extended his business to include compresses and warehouses. In 1948, Holiday Magazine did an issue on Texas. In this picture, it shows the business leaders of Dallas, and Father is standing in the back. In this picture, he is receiving wine coolers after retiring as president of the Dallas Cotton Exchange. He was also a member of the New York Cotton Exchange and was also on the board of the New Orleans Cotton Exchange. Here he is receiving a watch after retiring from the Dallas Cotton Shippers Association. Father got his first ranch in Quanah, Texas, and later acquired land in Rockwall, Kaufman, and Dallas counties to form Ebar S. Ranch. That became Marianne and Eugene's home. In the early 1960s, the city of Dallas took approximately 4,000 acres of the ranch to make Lake Ray Hubbard. Eugene and Father were always so disappointed to lose this land. These pictures are taken at the ranch house at Faye's third birthday. They are the last pictures taken of my father. In 1960, while playing golf at Brook Holly, he died of a heart attack. His close friend, Dr. Giles, was with him and said that he had a beautiful drive and sat down in the golf course and closed his eyes. This picture is at a party with mother, father, and his close friend, Dr. Robert Giles, who is sitting next to my mother. A few years before Father died, he had a carotid artery operation. Except for that, he had never been sick a day in his life. Eugene and I both felt we could have never had a more wonderful father. Now I will discuss the McGowan family. The first identifiable family member in America was James McGowan. He was born in South Carolina about 1750 and died in Scrivens County, Georgia about 1818. His son, James McGowan Jr., was born 1775 and married Mary Lewis. Mary and James McGowan Jr. became the stem from which our McGowan family descended. Their grandson, Alec McGowan, born in 1835, was my great-grandfather. After James McGowan died in 1808, Mary McGowan married Thomas Floyd, and all the family moved to Conecuh County, Alabama. Now our family receives checks from oil leases there. Alec was a great student of the Bible. When any of the family or the help were sick, he would read the Bible to them. He had a large plantation and was known as a model farmer. He made his living in farming, lumber, and his country store. Here's a picture of his home. Alex married his brother Peter's widow, Nancy. Peter had been killed in the Civil War. Alec McGowan fought in the war for 4 years, during which time he lost four brothers. The Civil War was such a terrible war. More soldiers were killed in the Civil War than in all the other wars of the United States put together. The South was broken after the war. 6 months after the war was over, an ex-slave ran in the house yelling, "Lord, Lord, I think I've seen a ghost." It was James McGowan returning from the war. The family thought he had died. None of the slaves left the family when the Union soldiers came through. Thank heaven slavery is over forever in the United States. Alex and Nancy had 6 children. One of them was my grandmother, Jessie McGowan. Okay. Now the Fauchy family. The Fauchys came from France to Rhode Island in the 18th century, then moved to Georgia. James Fauchy married Amanda Clements. They were my great-great-grandparents. He was a planter and a lumberman, and at the time of his death was quite wealthy as he owned several plantations and valuable lumber interests. His son, Stuart J. Fauchy, and Matilda were my great-grandparents. As a young man, he farmed and later graduated to the timber and logging business. The memorial records in Alabama in 1893 states, quote, "He was an example of a self-made man and with good business and management was one of the solid financial men of southern Alabama." He and his wife Matilda built a home in Brewton, Alabama. It was the first home in Brewton to have closets. They had 13 children. One was my grandfather, William Edward Fauchy. In 1896, he married his first cousin, Jessie McGowan. The wedding was described in the Brewton paper as being on a beautiful October evening. Quote, "Mr. Fauchy is a handsome, enterprising young businessman, one of the leading businessmen in the county, and his bride is so charming and accomplished. It is a pleasure to note under what bright prospects this couple enter the new era." My grandmother and grandfather Fauchy lived in Brewton, Alabama. They had 3 children, my mother, Uncle Stuart, and Aunt Edith. I adored Aunt Edith and Uncle Stuart. In 1902, my grandfather Fauchy and his father bought the W.T. Smith Lumber Company in Chapman, Alabama. In 1906, Grandfather Fauchy, his brother-in-law, Greeley McGowan, and cousin Willis and John McGowan bought into the company. That purchase has meant so much to our family through the years. The 4 families moved to Chapman and built 4 large houses side by side across from the railroad track. Chapman was a small village and had a commissary that sold only the bare necessities. For any other shopping, the families would take the L&N train to Montgomery, 80 miles away. The train would stop just for them to board and to return. This was Chapman in the early 1900s. This is a 1-room schoolhouse where my mother and her family received their education. Uncle Greeley's sister-in-law, Miss Stella Stallworth, was their teacher. Uncle Stuart, who is sitting behind Mother, graduated from the University of Alabama. Floyd McGowan in the back left and Earl McGowan in the front right graduated from the University of Alabama and later attended Oxford University. Earl was a Rhodes Scholar. Here are the Foshee and McGowan cousins. Here is Mother on the back steps of their house. Here are Grandmother and Grandfather Foshee. This was the family car. Mother said that she and Grandmother at first were so nervous about driving in it. Often when they were going down a steep hill, Grandfather would let them get out and walk down. Here are the Grand Dames of Chapman, all dressed up to go to Montgomery for the inauguration luncheon for Governor Henderson. In 1918, W. Smith Lumber Company became one of Alabama's leading industries. In 1949, Life magazine, the most popular magazine of the time, featured an article, quote, "The New South, its farms, factories, and folkways show exciting changes." It featured W.T. Smith Lumber Company and had a picture of Floyd, Earl, and Julian McGowan across from the mill. In 1966, when the company was sold, it had 220,000 acres of timberland. The families retained half the mineral rights. It was all family-owned, and the Montgomery Advertiser wrote, "The empire dissolves." In 1918, Grandfather Foshee moved the family to Montgomery, where he and Uncle Stuart started the Foshee Lumber Company. Grandmother and Grandfather were the most wonderful grandparents. Until Grandmother Foshee died while visiting us in 1942 on Lakeside Drive, Mother, Aline, Eugene, and I would spend a large part of the summer with her. She had a large house and yard, and there were lots of cousins to play with, and I loved it. Eugene always wanted to get back to Texas. My grandmother always wanted everyone to be happy, and she did all she could to make that happen. I think the nicest compliment my mother might have ever given me was that I had qualities like my grandmother. In 1918, Mother went to Ward Bell Modge College in Nashville, Tennessee. It was a prestigious finishing school for girls. Mother was an excellent businesswoman who always read business magazines and kept up with the stock market. She often said how much she would have liked to have gone to a business school which did not exist for women in her day. Eugene and I were so fortunate that she was such a good businesswoman. All her life, she loved beautiful clothes, and she always looked just right. She loved to buy clothes at Neiman Marcus for Mary Ann and me, and Mary, Nita, Beverly, Faye, and Ann. Mother enjoyed her lovely home on 4704 Lakeside, and all her family enjoyed it with her for so many different occasions. Most of all, she enjoyed her family. In 1998, when she was 98, at her water exercise class, the YMCA, she had a heart attack and died a few days later. It was a class she had attended 5 days a week for many years. She had lived on Lakeside Drive for 58 years. In 1924, my mother met my father while he was playing golf at the Montgomery Country Club. They married in June 1925 at my grandparents' home. The Montgomery Advertiser wrote, quote, "Marked by exceptional beauty and elegance and a prominent social interest was the wedding of Mary Foshee McGowan and Eugene Bragg Smith." Mother said it was the hottest night with candles everywhere. In fact, it was so hot the bridesmaids never wore their chiffon dresses again. Mother and father went on a long honeymoon first to Quebec, where they stayed at the Chateau Frontenac, and then visited other parts of Canada. On returning, they went to Quanah, where father had started Eugene B. Smith & Company. I was born in 1926 in Montgomery. Here I am with Mother and Grandmother Foshee. Here I am as a toddler. I am with Uncle Jack, Grandmother Foshee's cook, Bama, her maid, and their neighbor Tristan, who I used to fight all the time. This was my first long dress. Aline made it for me. Right after this portrait was made, I had my first haircut, which was one of the happiest days of my life. Eugene was born in 1928. Here he is with Mother and me. Here he is with Father. Around 1930 in Quanah, Aline Pollard was interviewed by my mother about helping with Eugene and me. Mother said that the two things she did not want to do was wait on the table and to wear a uniform. Mother's reply was, quote, "Aline, I could not care less." Aline was with us for over 50 years and was like another mother to Eugene and me. In 1933, we moved to Dallas to 3721 Potomac. Eugene was 5 and I was 7. Daisy Jackson started working for us as a cook and was with us for over 50 years. In 1941, we moved to 4704 Lakeside Drive. This picture was taken a little after we moved to Lakeside Drive. Meg was my first dog and lived to be 17. Growing up in Highland Park was ideal. Eugene went to Culver Military School and graduated from SMU. Here he is at graduation with Aline. I went to Highland Park Schools. This was my photo in my yearbook, how much my mother hated my dark lipstick. These are some of my high school friends that I still stay in touch with. I had 5 wonderful summers at camp, 2 at Camp Nakonagwa in Tennessee, 2 at Camp Greystone in North Carolina, and 1 at Camp Waldemar in Texas. These are of me at Camp Greystone. After Highland Park, I attended Bennett Junior College. It had been an old Victorian hotel in Millbrook, New York, and I did love it there. The countryside was so beautiful, and I rode horseback so much. Here I am in a horse show with my roommate, Gene Gaddis. This was at my graduation with Father, Gene, and Mr. Bowden, our riding instructor. After Bennett, I enjoyed my junior year at the University of Texas, where I was a member of Pi Beta Phi. My parents wanted me to make my debut the next year and then return to the university to graduate. Well, I did make my debut. However, that was the end of my formal education. Making my debut was exciting and fun. It was a short time after the war when everyone was ready for a party, as so many young men had come back to Dallas. I think that mother and father enjoyed my debut season as much as I did. I met Bob then. We were engaged in September and married in December. We married at St. Matthew's Cathedral and had the reception at my parents' home. On leaving for our honeymoon, some of the groomsmen knocked Bob down and kidnapped me. Here's Cullen, Bob's best man and preacher, helping him up. Here are the kidnappers bringing me back. We went to Jamaica and Cuba on our honeymoon. Mary Ann and Eugene were married a few years after Bob and I married. I think that Eugene and I were so very blessed to have grown up in the Park Cities at the time we did, and have had mother and father for our parents, and to have Aline and Daisy living with us. Now we'll discuss the Lydes. The Lydes are Welsh. Their name was first spelled Lude, then Lloyd, then it was anglicized to Lyde. In the early 1700s, 3 Lyde brothers, John, Thomas, and Robert, moved from Virginia to South Carolina. John Lyde's grandson was John Wild Lyde, who married Mary Lipscomb. They were Bob's great-grandparents. Around 1819, John Wild Lyde graduated from the medical college in Charleston and then moved to Tennessee. His son, Oscar Henry Lyde, married Emmy Pendleton and were Bob's grandparents. Their son, David, was Bob's dad. Dad was born in Tennessee and grew up in Shreveport, Louisiana. Here he is with his mother, Anna, and older brother, Maurice. I know very little of Dad as a child except how much he loved bird hunting and fishing. Here he is, a young man ready for fishing. For several years, Dad would enter the Tarpon Rodeo in Port Isabel, Texas. This shows him with Bob and Muggsy at one of the rodeos. Here he is many, many years later fishing at the plantation with Nita, Mary, and Preacher. Dad was one of the early pioneers in the oil business in Texas, Louisiana, and Mississippi, and was very successful. This article is about a discovery well of his. Here he is on an oil tank with 2 other men. Bob and Muggsy would visit him whenever he could find a decent place for them to stay, which was very difficult in the early oil fields. In the early 30s, he moved his family to Dallas because it was so much better place to do business in Shreveport. Also, he started to acquire land around Lake Bruin near Newellton, Louisiana, to have a place to hunt and fish. Lake Bruin had a 36-mile shoreline. In time, he acquired several thousand acres and spent most of his time there. He raised cotton, corn, and soybeans. He and Bob had a nice herd of cattle. First the Bremers, then the Santa Gertrudis, and last the Charlet. In World War II, with the federal government, Dad began a venture to sing Lake Bruin for sturgeon, also known as paddlefish. The roe was used for caviar. During the war, it was impossible to get caviar from Russia. This became a source for New York's finest restaurants. Dad loved being at his plantation, and to us it was paradise. We spent so many summers there, swimming in Lake Bruin, water skiing, fishing, riding, and having house parties. One of the main reasons we enjoyed the plantation so much was because of the people who worked there. Alice, she could hardly read or write, but was the most fabulous cook. Morel, Alice's husband, he worked in the yard. He had such a beautiful voice and preached on Sunday. Preacher, he worked in the garden and would take us fishing. He was such a character and always so much fun to be with. Emma, how I did love her. She helped me when I was a bride and knew absolutely nothing about running a house or cooking. I learned so much from her. Janie was a cook when Alice retired. She was wonderful, a gourmet cook and so smart. Dad was such a sweet and generous person. He adored his grandchildren from the day they were born. Here he is with Mary and Nita, and here he is with Beverly and Bob. I think that his very happiest times were when we were all together at the plantation. The Deloaches. I will refer to Bob's mother, Nita Deloach, as Muggsy. Bob always called her Muggsy, and so did all our family. The Deloaches were from Loach, France, a small town in the Loire Valley. They were Huguenots and fled from France in the 17th or 18th century because of the Roman Catholic persecution of Protestants. They probably went to England because King George III in 1747 gave a land grant of 200 acres in South Carolina to John Deloach, and in 1774 a land grant of 400 acres in South Carolina to Thomas Deloach. Muggsy is a direct descendant of Thomas Deloach. Thomas and his wife Lillian had five children. The eldest was Alfred B. Deloach Sr. In 1835, Alfred Deloach Jr. graduated from Transylvania College in Lexington, Kentucky, receiving a Ph.D. and a medical degree. He and his wife, Ethelda, moved to Livingston, Alabama. Besides his medical practice, he owned a drugstore, dealt in land, and became a very prominent citizen of Alabama. His eldest child, Alfred B. Deloach III, graduated from the medical college in Philadelphia in 1859. He served with honor in the Confederacy. He married Fanny Young. They were Muggsy's grandparents. In 1899, Franny Deloach received a letter from a Colonel J.B. Malone. He said that Dr. Deloach had saved his life in the Battle of Chickamauga. In accordance with all military laws, surgeons stay in the rear of the battle and care for the wounded. However, Dr. Deloach came to him in the midst of the battle and dragged him to safety. He said that Dr. Deloach was the bravest man he had ever known. Their son, Lawrence Deloach, Muggsy's father, married Madge Watts in 1894. Muggsy was the second of their nine children. She grew up in Shreveport and as a young lady was known for her readings at clubs and different organizations. In 1917, she married Dad in her parents' home, and in the early 1930s, Muggsy and Dad moved to Dallas. They built a lovely home on Turtle Creek Lane. It appeared on the June 1950 cover of House and Garden. It sited on Turtle Creek, and Dad had built a dam to have a small lake on his property. They sold the home when Bob was drafted and spent most of the time at the plantation. In 1947, they bought 3635 Beverly Drive and later downsized to the Terrace House. Here are two of the rooms there. Muggsy had such beautiful antiques. She had little interest in politics or business. Her interests were in decorating, gardening, cooking, and antiques. She excelled in all of these fields. She was very social and had lots of style. She was a member of many historical clubs, the Daughters of the American Revolution, the Colonial Dames, Daughters of the Republic of Texas, and many others. And her favorite literary club was the Matheon Club. Here she is as Cleopatra with other members in the club. She was a beautiful rider and at one time had a 5-gated horse which she showed. Muggsy loved the plantation as Dad did. She was responsible for the lovely furniture in all of our homes, the beautiful grounds, and so much of our delicious food came from her garden. Every evening we would have dinner under the fan on Muggsy and Dad's screen porch. The food was fabulous, and even on the hottest days, it always was comfortable there. Muggsy, unlike Dad, had little interest in her granddaughters when they were babies, but she more than made up for it when they were older. Here she is riding with Nita and Beverly. Here she is with Mary, Nita, and Beverly visiting Governor Jimmy Davis at the Governor's Mansion. Jimmy Davis, before he was governor, had a band and wrote the hit song, "You Are My Sunshine." We all had such a good time with Muggsy, and I feel the children were so very fortunate to have had the grandparents they had. And now Bob. Bob's real name was David Morrison Lyde, Jr. When he was a child, his favorite nursery rhyme was, "Little Bobby Shafto went to sea, silver buckles on his knee." From then on, he was called Bobby, and then Bob. He was born in 1919 in Shreveport and moved to Dallas in the early 1930s with his family. In high school, he graduated from Wentworth Military Academy in Lexington, Missouri, which he loved. I am certain that it meant so much to him later when he was in Officers Candidate School in Maryland. In college, he attended Southern Methodist University in Suwanee, University of the South, in Chattanooga, Tennessee. He was a member of Phi Delta Theta there. He was there when he was drafted. In World War II, he was one of the first 10 young men to be drafted from Dallas. The papers here wanted to do articles on these young men. Muggsy would give them no information on Bob. She hoped if she didn't talk about it, that it would just go away. You can imagine how concerned she must have been. He fought in North Africa, Sicily, and was in the invasion of Anzio Beach in Italy. Towards the end of the war, Bob was in North Italy when a beautiful Springer Spaniel took up with him. He named him Dan'l and smuggled him in his duffel bag onto the troop ship and brought him back to the plantation. Dan'l spent the rest of his life very much loved at the plantation. Here he is with Muggsy. Bob loved animals. Bob had been made a major by the end of the war. After the war, Bob worked with Dad in the oil business and at the plantation, especially with the cattle. Shortly after we married, he worked with my father with cotton and gin warehouses. Then he started his real estate company. Our first home was at 3904 Miramar, where we lived for 15 years. Mary, Nita, and Beverly were born while we lived there, and it was such a great neighborhood for children. Zarla Mendoza and Erlinda Rubio helped me on Miramar. Zarla's son Hector was born when we lived there and we adored him. In 1965, we moved to 4208 Lorraine, where I am still enjoying living. Through all the years, we all attended St. Michael's and All Angels Church, which had grown from a small chapel to the second largest Episcopal church in the country. Bob had such a great sense of humor and was such an extrovert. He was a good squash player until his knees gave out. Then he took up golf. I enjoyed tennis and golf so much. I enjoyed my 15 years in real estate so much. It was so nice to work with Tom and Carol McBride. For both Bob and me, the very best part of our lives was the times we spent with our families, including our four-legged members.
Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, baby, kiss me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing. true. In other words, I love you. Song, let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue, clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more. And I never knew, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
I think that God has given me such a beautiful life.